Our Sunday morning worship comes from Sutton Coalfield.
Welcome to St Mary's College, Oscott. Today, looking out over the city, it looks rather like Christmas. Despite the fact the sun is shining, the city is covered in snow. But in fact, you join the staff, the students and their families to celebrate Easter Day. Our prayer and praise today will be led by the Archbishop of Birmingham, Maurice Coeur de Mourvil. The college was founded in 1794, about a mile away from here. This has been our home since 1838. We're very conscious that many great men and women have enriched our college's story. John Henry Newman, in July 1852, preached from the pulpit we'll use this morning for the gospel proclamation, his sermon, The Second Spring. The Second Spring, a proclamation of hope where all seem dead and decaying. It is that same promise and hope that we proclaim from the very beginning of our Easter Day Mass as we sing.
Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Peace be with you.
And also with you.
We start this Easter Mass by singing to the risen and victorious Christ our hymn of praise. Glory to God, glory in the highest.
Glory to God.
Let us pray that the risen Christ will raise us up and renew our lives. God our Father, creator of all, today is the day of Easter joy. This is the morning on which the Lord appeared to men who had begun to lose hope and opened their eyes to what the scriptures foretold, that first he must die, and then he would rise and ascend into the Father's glorious presence. May the risen Lord breathe on our minds and open our eyes, that we may know him in the breaking of bread and follow him in his risen life. Grant this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
A reading from the Acts of the Apostles. Peter opened his mouth and said, "You know the word which was proclaimed throughout all Judea, beginning from Galilee, after the baptism which John preached, how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and with power, how he went about doing good and healing all that were oppressed by the devil, for God was with him. And we are witnesses to all that he did, both in the country of the Jews and in Jerusalem. They put him to death by hanging him on a tree. But God raised him on the third day and made him manifest, not to all the people, but to us who were chosen by God as witnesses, who ate and drank with him after he rose from the dead. And he commanded us to preach to the people and to testify that he is the one ordained by God to be judge of the living and the dead. To him all the prophets bear witness that everyone who believes in him receives forgiveness of sins through his name. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
This day was made by the Lord. We rejoice and are glad.
This day was made by the Lord. We rejoice and are glad.
give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, for his love has no end. Let the sons of Israel say, his love has no end.
This day was
die, but I shall live and recount his deeds.
This day was made by the Lord, we rejoice and are glad.
The stone which the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. This is the work of the Lord, a marvel in our eyes.
This day was made by the Lord, we rejoice and are glad.
A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Colossians. If you have been raised with Christ, seek the things that are above, where Christ is, seated at the right hand of God. Set your mind on things that are above, not on things that are on earth. For you have died, and your life is hid with Christ in God. When Christ, who is our life, appears, then you also will appear with him in glory. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Reading from the Holy Gospel according to John.
Glory to you, Lord.
On the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene came to the tomb early, while it was still dark, and saw that the stone had been taken away from the tomb. So she ran and went to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one whom Jesus loved, and said to them, "They have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we do not know where they have laid him." Peter then came out with the other disciple, and they went toward the tomb. They both ran, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. And stooping to look in, he saw the linen cloths lying there, but he did not go in. Then Simon Peter came, following him, and went into the tomb. He saw the linen cloths lying, and the napkin which had been on his head, not lying with the linen cloths, but rolled up in a place by itself. Then the other disciple, who reached the tomb first, also went in, and he saw and believed. For as yet they did not know the scripture, that he must rise from the dead. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. But like the rector, I too want to welcome to you. Say welcome to you all to this Mass of the Easter morning at Oscott. I say these words to the parents and the families of the students here, and also to the viewers, wherever they may be, who are looking in to our celebration through the television. It's very good to have you with us at this Mass. I hope you enjoy coming to Oscott as much as I do, because since I first came to the Midlands a year ago, I have loved coming to this college, which I scarcely knew before. It's the Diocesan Seminary of Birmingham, but it's a place where men from other parts of England and Wales also come to be trained for the Catholic priesthood. As the rector mentioned, the college was originally started in what looks like a manor house in a village called Old Oscott now, which is at the bottom of the hill and is a suburb of Birmingham. That was in 1794. It's a time when Catholic education wasn't allowed by law in England, although there was a surprising amount of it going on in the Midlands. And then in 1829 came Catholic emancipation, and soon afterwards, in 1838, New Oscott was built. That's where we are now. There's nothing hole in the corner about this place. It stands boldly on a hill, and the Victorians reveled in their opulent version of the Gothic style as they embellished every nook and cranny with carving and gilding and painting. I do hope the television cameras are treating you to the full works. The building is planned to look outwardly like an Oxford college. It's got an inner courtyard, great noble gateway, and that was a conscious attempt to pick up the traditions of England's Catholic past. On the first floor, there's a room called the Bishop's Room. Actually, it's called the Episcopium. That was another bit of England's Catholic past. And the college is kind enough to put it at my disposal when I come to stay here. And from its window, I can look out and see the whole city of Birmingham with its skyscrapers and the post office tower and the sprawling development of a big modern city. And when I look out, I tremble and I think what a responsibility it is to be Archbishop of Birmingham. How can the gospel be preached today to such a huge agglomeration with so many inner city problems and suburban problems, and so many people who do not know their right hand from their left? Those are my thoughts
as I look out of the window on the first floor. And then I think of the appearance of the risen Christ to the disciples in the upper room. And I remember that they were few in number, and they had to bring the message of the resurrection of Christ to the whole of the ancient world, Jews and Gentiles alike. That must have been far worse than being Archbishop of Birmingham. And they didn't have the help of central television to get their message. How did they do it? As far as we can see, they didn't use sophisticated media techniques, but they spoke about Jesus risen from the dead at Easter. They had seen the empty tomb. They had seen the risen Jesus. They'd heard him speak, and they had touched him. And from then on, he was a reality which they shared and lived by. Very soon, in the renewal of the baptismal promises in this Mass, I shall be saying, "Dear friends, through the Paschal mystery, we have been buried with Christ in baptism so that we may rise with him to new life." Well, it's that new life that the apostles experienced in the Spirit of Christ. And it's that that they communicated to their hearers. For anyone who is in Christ, there is a new creation. The old creation has gone, and now the new one is here. Those were the words of St. Paul that the Pope quoted when he ordained 14 men to the priesthood at Heaton Park, Manchester, on the 31st of May last year. And I'm quoting them this morning because there's something absolutely right about the celebration of Easter in a seminary which is training men for the priesthood. You see, the priesthood, like the consecrated state of monks and nuns, is a sign to the present age of the reality of that new creation which was inaugurated by the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Men and women consecrated to the service of the church give up marriage, not because they think marriage is wrong. Far from it. Everyone knows that the Catholic Church has always upheld the value of marriage and has said that it's one of the sacraments of Jesus Christ. But there is a reality breaking through into this present world which is even greater than married love. And that is the uncreated love of God in the hearts of men and women who believe in his Son. That is the kingdom that Jesus spoke about so much. And his resurrection is the beginning of that kingdom in our world. To someone who has seen that and experienced that reality, no sacrifice is too great for the sake of the kingdom. And there is urgency in spreading that good news to the world. That is why these young men here spend 6 years at Oscott preparing for their ordination to the priesthood by becoming, in a special way, the friends and the disciples of Jesus. It's so good to see here this morning their parents and their brothers and sisters. And to them I say, I know how much the students here need your support and help in their years of preparation. Because it is hard to accept voluntarily celibacy for the service of the kingdom. But that is undoubtedly what the church asks of her priests in today's world, as the present Pope has so often reminded us. Of course, it's the presence of these young men here which gives me courage as bishop in the task of evangelization, because I know that just as the disciples left everything and preached the gospel without thought of personal gain, So, in today's world, God calls forth priests as men who are equally dedicated to the work of spreading his gospel. And so with them, I have the privilege of speaking to all of you who are watching on the television screens. Perhaps some of you are bedridden or housebound or even far away from home at this Easter time. But to all of you, the message of the Church is the same, whether it's spoken by Pope or Archbishop or by priest or layperson. It is, Christ is risen. He is truly alive, and he wants you to share in his risen life. Will you believe that? This is the message of Easter. Accept it as true. The Church doesn't come to you asking you first to change yourself for the better, or to be respectable or good. It asks you to believe, for justification is by faith. And if you believe, the life of Christ will be given to you, and then all these other things will be added to you as well. In a few moments, I will ask the people present in this chapel to renew the promises of their baptism. I shall question them, asking, do you believe in God the Creator, in Jesus who rose from the dead, in the Spirit who lives in his Church? And to all of you who are watching, I ask the same questions. The message of the Church is the truth that we live to serve. Do you believe it? Well, do you? Dear friends, through the Paschal Mystery, we have been buried with Christ in baptism, so that we may rise with him to new life. Now that we have completed our Lenten observance, let us renew the promises that we made in baptism, when we rejected Satan and his works, and promised to serve God faithfully in his holy Catholic Church. And so, do you reject Satan?
I do.
And all his works?
I do.
And all his empty promises?
I do.
Do you believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth?
I do.
Do you believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was born of the Virgin Mary, was crucified, died and was buried, rose from the dead, and is now seated at the right hand of the Father?
I do.
Do you believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting?
I do.
God, the all-powerful Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, has given us new birth by water and the Holy Spirit, and forgiven all our sins. May he also keep us faithful to our Lord Jesus Christ forever and ever.
Amen.
This day was made by the Lord. With joyful confidence, let us pray.
That Christians may come to bear united witness to their risen Lord, let us pray.
Lord, in your mercy,
hear our
that Elizabeth, our Queen, and all the royal family may know the blessings of Easter Day, let us pray.
Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
That those who at home or in hospital share our prayer and praise may receive comfort from Jesus, risen from the dead. Let us pray.
Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
that our absent students, John O'Donnell and Stephen Dodd, and those dear to us who support us by their prayer, may share our joyful praise. Let us pray. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Mary stood by the cross of Jesus, her son, and now shares his life and joy. To her let us commend our prayer as we sing. Regina Caeli,
Les Are, Alleluia. We are Neverus in Portare, Alleluia. Resurrexit, Sicut dixit, Alleluia.
Father, you gave joy to the world through the resurrection of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. Through the prayers of the Virgin Mary, his mother, may we come to the fullness of joy in his kingdom, where he lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
Take, Lord, receive all my liberty. My memory, understanding, my entire
thank you.
Pray, brethren, that our sacrifice may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and good of all his church.
Lord, accept the prayers and offerings of your people. With your help, may this Easter mystery of our redemption bring to perfection the saving work that you have begun in us. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
Father, all-powerful and ever-living God, we do well, always and everywhere, to give you thanks through Jesus Christ our Lord. We praise you with greater joy than ever on this Easter day, when Christ became our paschal sacrifice. He is the true Lamb who took away the sins of the world. By dying, he destroyed our death. By rising, he restored our life. And so, with all the choirs of angels in heaven, we proclaim your glory and join in their unending hymn of praise.
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God and God of might, heaven and earth, heaven and earth, heaven and earth,
Father, with praise and thanksgiving through Jesus Christ, your Son. Through him, we ask you to accept and bless these gifts we offer you in sacrifice. We offer them for your holy Catholic Church. Watch over it, Lord, and guide it. Grant it peace and unity throughout the world. We offer them for John Paul, our Pope, for me, your unworthy servant, and for all who hold and teach the Catholic faith that comes to us from the apostles.
Remember, Lord, your people, especially those for whom we now pray. Remember especially Father Bill O'Brien. Remember all of us gathered here before you You know how firmly we believe in you and dedicate ourselves to you. We offer you this sacrifice of praise for ourselves and those who are dear to us. We pray to you, our living and true God, for our well-being and redemption.
In union with the whole Church, we celebrate that day when Jesus Christ, our Lord, rose from the dead in his human body. We honour Mary, the ever-Virgin Mother of Jesus Christ, our Lord and God. We honour Joseph, her husband, the apostles and martyrs, Peter and Paul, Andrew and all the saints. May their merits and prayers gain us your constant help and protection.
Father, accept this offering from your whole family and from those born into the new life of water and the Holy Spirit, with all their sins forgiven. Grant us your peace in this life, save us from final damnation, and count us among those you have chosen.
Bless and approve our offering. Make it acceptable to you, an offering in spirit and in truth. Let it become for us the body and blood of Jesus Christ, your only Son, our Lord. The day before he suffered, he took bread in his sacred hands, and looking up to heaven, to you, his almighty Father, he gave you thanks and praise. He broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take this, all of you, and eat it. This is my body, which will be given up for you."
When
supper was ended, he took the cup. Again he gave you thanks and praise, gave the cup to his disciples and said, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. This is the cup of my blood, the blood of the new and everlasting covenant. It will be shed for you and for all men, so that sins may be forgiven. Do this in memory of me."
Let us proclaim the mystery of faith.
Dying, you destroy
your Son. We, your people and your ministers, recall his passion, his resurrection from the dead, and his ascension into glory. And from the many gifts you have given us, we offer to you, God of glory and majesty, this holy and perfect sacrifice, the bread of life, and the cup of eternal salvation.
Look with favor on these offerings, and accept them as once you accepted the gifts of your servant Abel, the sacrifice of Abraham, our father in faith, and the bread and wine offered by your priest Melchizedek. Almighty God,
We pray that your angel may take this sacrifice to your altar in heaven. Then as we receive from this altar the sacred body and blood of your Son, let us be filled with every grace and blessing.
Remember, Lord, those who have died and have gone before us marked with the sign of faith, especially those for whom we now pray. May these and all who sleep in Christ find in your presence light, happiness, and peace.
For ourselves too, we ask some share in the fellowship of your apostles and martyrs, with John the Baptist, Stephen, Matthias, Barnabas, Agnes, Cecilia, Anastasia, and all the saints. Though we are sinners, we trust in your mercy and love. Do not consider what we truly deserve, but grant us your forgiveness.
Through Christ our Lord, you give us all these gifts. You fill them with life and goodness. You bless them and make them holy.
Through him, with him, in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, O mighty Father, forever and ever.
Call God our Father, and so we have the courage to say,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us.
Deliver us, Lord, from every evil, and grant us peace in our day. In your mercy, keep us free from sin, and protect us from all anxiety, as we wait in joyful hope for the coming of our Saviour, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, I leave you peace, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and grant us the peace and unity of your kingdom, where you live for ever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Let us offer each other the sign of peace. Happy are those who are called to his supper.
Lord, I am not worthy to receive you, but only say the word, and I shall be healed.
Our soul is all ours, we praise you, and
as men.